Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Exceptional Conservative Show, live from the nation's capital on the Exceptional Conservative Network. We're not ashamed of the good news of conservatism, for it is the power of liberation. First to the Republican and then the Socialist. So glad to have you here tonight. We want to pick up where we were. Love you, Mary. Mary Brockman, my bounce, is in the chat room. The beautiful Claudia Cheek, also in the chat room. Love you dearly. I didn't get a chance to talk with you all about the real sex scandal in America. The Seattle mayor, who basically decided that it was okay to sexually assault some children. Didn't get a chance to go over that. I will go over that with you tonight when we talk with Lonnie Poindexter. And that will be in the last quarter of this particular program, this particular program hour. We'll also be talking with the Kraken himself, Ralph J. Chittum Sr. Had a wonderful time on his show this afternoon. And that is the right guy. And as well, we will attempt to contact Shannon Wright so that she could drop the mic for us. She's out there in California, IA, or at least thereabouts. And so we're missing her, and we want to hear some good words from her. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we have scheduled the appearance of George Timothy Farrell. Not only is he a great real estate developer and author of Angry Black Man, Guide to Success, and Success is Colorblind. He released that last year. But he is also the founder of a super PAC called Black PAC. And it is geared to attract conservative minority voters and elect conservative candidates who support pro-life, traditional family values, and the Second Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. I want him on my program, even though he attended Archbishop John Carroll Catholic School, which was my rival school as I attended Mackin, Bishop Mackin Catholic High School. But we'll let him on anyway to talk with us. So coming up in a few moments, none other than George Timothy Farrell. I forgive him for going to Carroll. You know, some people had to go, you know, kept the Catholic school industry alive. I forgive him. Hopefully you will too. So glad to have you all here with me this particular evening. You know how we get this particular broadcast off and underway. Behind me, I have put this heavy, for those who are watching via Ustream and live stream, I have put this very heavy plaque here that I used to carry with me over my shoulder while I was doing the Pledge of Allegiance here. Hopefully you'll be able to see the words. For those who are following us on live stream, huge flag over to my left, your right. And for those who are following us on Ustream, you can see the big flag, little flag right behind me. There you go, right there. We pledge allegiance to the United States of America every night that we do our program. And we're watched over kindly by none other than Mary Brockman, who is my bouncer in chief. If you diss her, you diss me, you will be dismissed from our program. Just want to let you know, don't be offended. I'm not going to snatch you up like they do at United. I just want you to know you will not be welcomed here if you disturb my very beautiful and very brilliant bouncer. Just want to let you know that. So what we're going to do, we're going to ask that you put your right hand over your heart and let us pledge allegiance to the United States of America. Take it away, kids.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
That's what I talk about. Ladies and gentlemen, in a few moments, let us get the great George T. Farrell onto our network here. Let's see, what's going on in that chat room? Ken, Claudia, Mary. Okay, great. I done did. I done did. Oh, I love it. Love it. Let us get Mr. Farrell, George T. Farrell, on the line with us. One Mississippi, two Mississippi, three Mississippi, one ringy dingy, two ringy dingy, three ringy dingy. The great George T. Farrell. All right. Mind you, I'm...
Hello.
Good evening. This is the Exceptional One, Kevin McClinton. You are live on the Exceptional Conservative Show. George T. Farrell.
Yes, sir.
Great.
Yes, sir. How are you doing?
I am doing extremely well. I am honored and graced by your presence on our particular program this evening. And I want to, right off the bat, George, I just want to forgive you for going to John Carroll High School. I attended Mackin High School, so you understand what I'm saying.
Oh, I thought you were a Johnny Mom. Oh, my God.
As a fellow conservative, there's some things you just can't get over, and that's one of them.
Oh man, oh yeah, Mackin with the what was that basketball player had, Johnny something?
We had Johnny. Ooh, yeah, we had Johnny. Yeah. Mhm. And we had Nate Archibald too. Yeah, we had some great players. Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
Don't Joan.
Your listeners are going to say, what are they talking about?
What are they talking about? Listen, when we were in high school, when we were young, there were five high schools that literally took up the top 20 in basketball. They were DeMatha, they were Mackin, they were Carroll. That's right. They were St. John's and Gonzaga, and it was hate amongst us, and it was a great joy to actually go to those particular high schools, in fact, not just because of the rivalries, but because of the relationships that we've had afterwards, and it's just an honor and privilege to have you on the air with us tonight, sir.
Oh, thank you very much. So how's it going?
It's going extremely well. It's going better that you're here with us. You are working on a project which I think is so well needed in our community. Let me just say this to you. First and foremost, great books. Glad you wrote them. And I want to talk with you about those in the due season. But I want to spend the first couple of minutes here. You, a real estate developer in Washington, D.C.,
yes.
Why do you publicly tell people that you're a Republican?
You know why? Because when they have trouble, they come to me for help.
Exactly.
The Democrat gets trouble, they don't call another Democrat. They call a Republican.
So true. So very true.
The weird part is, I have other friends who are, John Thompson came with the term welfare pimps.
Yes, exactly.
And they have been welfare pimping for years.
Mm-hmm.
And they would tell me that Ben Carson was an Uncle Tom and all this stuff. And I would say, oh my God, I can't believe you said that. So now they're all in line ready to talk to Ben Carson and say what a nice guy and what a hero he is. I said, wait a minute, 6 months ago you called him Uncle Tom. All the Democratic welfare pimps, I'm sorry. kissing up to Ben Carson.
I feel a government contract underway here. It's all about the government contract.
Like, wow, I can't believe you guys slipped so quickly.
They are hung by the noose of the government contract, and quite frankly, it's good to see them kissing up to Dr. Carson. You've been in Washington for forever. Just like myself, and I wanted to ask you in this regard, are you noticing any changes whatsoever in Washington, D.C. in terms of people moving towards the right, or is this really a really fortress for the Democrat and leftist parties?
The Washington, D.C. will remain a leftist group because of the way people move in, stay, make a career, work for government, move out. And there's always two different Washingtons. The Washington we grew up in, and the Washington, the government Washington. Now, there was a time when, people made their families in Washington and things like that. But Washington's going to stay liberal because they can't get the school system together, so you don't want to move there. And like our parents did, sacrifice and send to private school, unless you can afford a private school. And you're not going to sacrifice your kids to D.C. public schools or charter schools. Although I think the charter schools in Washington are very, very good.
Yes.
So it's just a tough place to become a Republican. I remember a long time, years and years, probably decades ago, attending a meeting at the RNC where we used to ask for someone to back up. Let us break the barrier of Dave Clark being the only white guy that was elected who now has a law school named after him. I'm giving history now.
Mr. Bicycle Man.
Mr. Bicycle Man. Let us at least find a black Republican to run and support or something, because it was embarrassing. But, you know, I guess in one of the books, I praised Marion Barry because Marion Barry understood money and policy. And if you get to the truth, I mean, he created Kathy Hughes, billionaire, and Bob Johnson, billionaire. He gave Bob Johnson a cable contract, started in Southeast D.C., and which then turned into BET. And if people don't know, it was a BET was only on for 3 hours a day.
Thank you. and one of those hours was Donnie Simpson. That was about it.
But he's gone on to do some great things. But he's, you know, he has his back. Forget it. He's a Republican. I love her to death. She has a piece of the MGM I read the other day. They're making a tremendous profit. So, and actually, my aunt's friend who went there, Carol Dorsey Miller, who's president of Industrial Bank, really great guy. I did this with him years and years ago. He's actually been in meetings with the president. I was like, this is Dorsey.
But apparently the Democrats understand that the motif, if you don't win, is still to hold on to the Treasury. And they have that down pat. They have a stranglehold on Maryland. They have a stranglehold on Northern Virginia. They have a stranglehold on D.C. in local politics. And you are going to be the vibrant force to change that. When we come back after this break, and thank you so much for bearing with me on tearing down John Carroll High School.
I don't think your school had a football team.
No, we didn't. We didn't have a football game. We watched a lot of John Carroll football games. When we come back, fellow conservative George T. Farrell is with us tonight, and we're going to talk about Black Pack. We're going to talk about elections coming forward and the magnitude of strength that we have to have. And I know a lot of people are saying, you know, you're using the term weekend. We, in the sense of what a lot of urban conservatives will have to do, including coming out of the closet. When we start doing that, there could be some changes. We'll be right back. Hang on with me. In 2 minutes, 2 seconds, we'll be right back with more of the best in urban conservative talk.
Good morning.
I'm Michael Wright.
And I'm Shannon Wright.
Okay, folks, that's not how it goes. I think I'm Shannon, and you're Michael.
Yeah.
Okay. We are The Right Way with Shannon and Mike.
Join us from 7 to 9 a.m. Eastern Time.
Live on SHR Media.
And on TECN.
Where we'll be talking about all kinds of things.
From sports and politics.
To food and entertainment.
To money.
Family.
and anything else in between.
Community, holidays, all kinds of
people. It'll be great. Join us from 7 to 9 a.m. Eastern Time.
Begin your mornings the right way with some right thinking from me, Perry Drake, your friendly neighborhood drive-by pundit. I want you to join me every Tuesday and Thursday at 10 a.m. Eastern and 9 a.m. Central Time on the Exceptional Conservative Network. From politics to pop culture to relationships to whatever else is on your mind, we have a great deal to talk about. Join in and let's get the talking started.
Hi, my name is Willie Lawson of the Willie Lawson Show here on the Exceptional Conservative Network. We have a brand new show on at 9 a.m. Monday through Friday. We are bound to make you think. We are bound to make you see things differently. We are bound to push you into action for not only your community, but your country. That's the Willie Lawson Show on the Exceptional Conservative Network, 9 a.m. Monday through Friday. See you there.
Ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you back to the Exceptional Conservative Network. You're listening to the Exceptional Conservative Show live from Washington, D.C. We have a very good friend with us tonight, George Farrell, who is the founder, along with his wife. You got to give props to the wife, right? Miss Lopez. founder of Black Pack. It is so good to have you here tonight, sir.
Great, great. Let me do a plug. It's BLAKPAC and two websites, .GOP and BLAKPAC.com. So keep two websites up, multiple Twitters, Instagram, and Facebook. So take a look at our webpage, join us, and if you can, make a donation, because we live off these small donations, $10 to $25. A ton of the funding comes from me personally.
Exactly. Well, listen, I think it's tremendous what you're doing. And we need to have a lunch sometime where we could talk about how we could work together. Me with my network here in D.C. and you with Black Pack to reach out to a lot of individuals who should be in the fore of our political well-being, but unfortunately have been shamed away. You are drafting a campaign to bring David Clark to the Senate, and I want to get your thought. Why David Clark? Don't you know he's a Democrat?
I know he is a Democrat. but there's several reasons for David Clark, and it's not just David Clark the person. But one of the things we found when we started on January 9th of 2002 was when Black Pack was chartered by the Federal Election Commission, is that with the candidates that we were supporting didn't have the name recognition or the funding to get started. Now, we make a major difference if you're in a close race and you need to go from 2 to 4% to put you over the top.
Yeah.
But we can't take you from zero to hero.
Uh-huh. So yeah, exactly.
We ran into a lot of candidates that didn't even have $50,000 to pump to buy their own signs and things like that. So what we found that we have to do is we really have to draft name candidates that are out there, like a Jennifer Carroll, Sheriff Clark, or Albert Guillory, or Alvin West.
Yes.
And those are the candidates that we put out there. There's two reasons. One, we need a strong figure, someone who's not going to get elected and, what I say, turn into a turtle. Which means they pull them in here, and you can't find them, you can't hear from them, they never return a call.
Exactly.
So we need some folks who are brave and strong. And that's why David Clark, he just speaks his mind. Whatever he says comes out.
Oh, yeah.
And he stands up to foolishness. Mm-hmm. And he speaks back to white people. So hard to find a strong black man to speak back to a white person.
Very true. That's very true.
I'm going to get a lot of criticism on that, but there's a reason for David Clark. Two is to give the example, because it's very hard to raise funds for black candidates and black conservative candidates.
Yeah.
One, that funding network is not there. Mm-hmm. So David Clark is kind of like the way we open the door to find out who's really going to support a black conservative candidate. So we do it. We push him for two reasons. One, because he's a good candidate. Even though our latest poll shows him 65-45 because his candidate he's running against an open lesbian woman.
Yes.
Which is going to be tough to beat.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But we can, you know, we have a year to work on it and to knock her negatives down. She's done nothing for veterans. She's got a horrible record. So we have some time. And one of the ads we ran, I don't know if you saw our More Clark, Less Snoop ad, which ran in the printed edition of the Milwaukee Community Journal, which is the largest black paper in Milwaukee.
Mm-hmm.
So, mm-hmm. And that ad got a lot of reviews. We had it on our Twitter, and it had a picture of Sherrod Clark and Snoop, and it says one has character and one is a character. We have to teach black youth the difference between one having character and one is a character. So Black Pack shares a lot of, you know, to me, it's like the way Walt Disney took a mouse and made him into a star.
Exactly. Exactly. You speak to,
but if that mouse is on your floor, you want to kill it.
Exactly. You speak to the fact that, and let's just be honest, when we have a Donald John Trump, president of the United States, 45th, who mentions the term winning. You can't really say that black conservatives have won anything since about 1950. Why are you spending time raising money for black conservatives who lose, sir?
Well, here's the thing. In the big dog, I was at the RNC meeting, the spring meeting, 3 weeks ago. It's in Palm Beach at the Four Seasons.
Mm-hmm.
And I met Ronna Romney, Mr. Chair. And I'm in a room everybody's a millionaire in this room. The speaker is Steve Lim from Vegas.
Mm, yes.
So to enter this room was $330,000.
Wait a minute, hold up. I think that's my mortgage. What?
That was the cost of entry to get into the spring meetings at the that's just it. So I'm sitting there, and it starts to hit me that we have 0.005% black Republican members of Congress. Tim Scott, Will Hurd, Mia Love. That comes out to 0.005% of 535 people. So when you don't even have enough people to make a difference. So I'm sitting there with a major donor. The guy can write a check for $1,500,000.
Yeah.
He pretty much says, your PAC is not even worth me investing in because you can't make a difference.
Wow.
That's the thing I care about. So I'm like, wow, thanks for breaking it down and being so honest.
Wow. George, would you say that again? Would you say that again so that those who are listening around the world understand what we put up with as conservatives? We're invited to the party. We just can't eat. You know what I'm saying?
We can't eat. So, this major donor, I mean, we're 20 million, middle 20, 30 million, okay. And I'm making my pitch, you know, invest in Black Pack. We need some big donors to come through. And if you look at our FEC report, it's all small donors, $5 to $25, maybe a couple hundred dollars. So, it's all this is open record, open secrets, like that thing says.
Exactly.
So, when you look at this, and I'm like, I can't get a big donor. I want to go with a big donor. And he pretty much breaks it down, saying, you know, you're irrelevant in the Republican Party, and maybe in life. So you can't, I mean, Tim Scott's one vote in the Senate doesn't matter to him. Mia Love and Will Hurd's two votes in the House doesn't matter to a guy who wants to influence policy and legislation. And that's the reason they're in politics.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the reason they write the big checks. So they'll run to the AI pack. But mm-hmm. to me, I don't have enough people in Congress to make a difference. So our goal is to, in 2018 is going to be a major shakeup year in the midterm election, is to try to double that number every 2 years. Double the number of black conservatives in Congress every 2 years. And if we can do that from 3 to 6 to 9, we'll get to the point where we do make a difference and where that vote is relevant and where my Democrats don't get to jump in front and go meet with Donald Trump where the Republicans are still waiting for me. So.
Exactly. But we hear that message so much. And there were some other things, but I'm going to have you come back and talk about those things. But we hear this message. See, what people don't understand is that the public message that's given to us is, come on in. The pool is fine. But when you get there, they give you the outfit for the cabana boy to clean it up, per se, not to actually get in and swim. And the reason is that we aren't bringing enough conservatives to the party in of ourselves, and we don't even invest in ourselves. You mentioned earlier the fact that there are individuals who run for office, and what they expected when they ran for office is to get this big send-off out of the primary from the GOP, and the GOP was like crickets. They weren't there because they were not expecting you to win in the urban marketplace. Am I right on this?
You're very right. And it's sad. Somehow, like, why do we do this? We do this because we know that the conservative values are the correct values for our society.
Yeah.
And the Democratic Party doesn't just support abortion, they promote it. Yes, they advertise it.
Yes. Have you aborted your baby today? Come on now.
Yeah, come with us. I mean, the things they promote are not friendly to the Black community. Mm-hmm. So it's the Republican Party that actually is talking about justice reform and lower taxes and good schools and school choice and the legal ability to carry a firearm. Those are Second Amendment rights. Those are things the Republican Party stands for. Those are the conservative values that our parents grew up with, that we grew up with, and they match the Republican Party. They don't match the Democratic Party. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we have a lot of people in the Republican Party that are really rhinos that are Republicans in name only.
Yeah, most certainly. So,
and those are the people who are actually leading the party.
Exactly. And
but
you know,
there's a revolt going on. There's a revolt.
Well, I'm hoping that there is a revolt.
In 2018, there's going to be a lot of new members. I was actually going to come up with a slogan on practice that New Year's Day will be November 8th, 2018. Because that's where we're going to come in with the new and out with the old. We're going to throw out all these old rhino candidates and get some real conservatives elected. And there's some great people. It's not just me. It's Daryl Glenn up in Colorado.
Yes, I love Daryl. Oh, yeah. Love Daryl.
Daryl Glenn, yeah, he came closest to winning of all the new people who are running. And he's sitting there waiting to see what opens up. So he's a good guy. I talk to him probably once a month.
Mm-hmm.
So we got some great candidates that we're going to push. We're going to draft some new candidates that have name recognition. And we've got some young people who are making a difference. Actually, in Virginia, I cannot remember Laquan's last.
Uh-huh. No problem.
But he's running for a state rep seat in Virginia. But his first name is Laquan, young man. Getting into politics, he actually has won the primary on the Republican side, and he's running for a state seat in Virginia. And we're looking at giving him some support. I've got another young lawyer down here in Florida running for a state house seat. His name is, he's a Haitian gentleman. His name is Bernie Jacques.
Yes.
So we're building a farm team at the state level so we can get these guys ready to run for Congress when the time comes.
Well, first and foremost, we're talking tonight with George T. Farrell, and we're going to have him come back on a lot more often during the next 12 months, 18 months, in fact, going into election 2018, because people need to know.
Thank you.
No, really, people need to know that Black PAC exists, Raynard Jackson's Black Americans for a Better Future. They need to know that you all exist.
Yes.
And that you are supporters of them in the cause. But come on, the guys that you all normally pick are, they got the Jerry Curl juice thing still going, they not very, good in front of the camera, a whole lot.
I don't pick candidates like that.
You don't? Okay, all right.
Well, I don't pick candidates. We're trying to pick some women candidates. We're trying to find some women candidates too.
Exactly. What is a good cat for those who are listening? And saying, I want to get into this political thing. I'm tired of throwing my bedroom shoes at the TV screen. And I think I can make a difference. When they get in contact with you, what is the first thing you want to hear?
I want to hear that they've got some community backing. I want to hear that they've got some money to put into a race. They're not running no dollars.
This ain't real estate. 100%.
And we get the people with passion, but no funding. But they got to understand. I mean, even a little race like a city council race, which is major in D.C., but a lot of little city races, and we need some good people on school boards. School boards,
yes,
usually actually pay a salary. So I tell a lot of people, start with school boards if you care about schools, because at least you're going to make an investment, but at least you're going to get some back. A lot of state house seats don't pay anything.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It's access. It's access.
It actually, our name, Black Pack, comes with Black Leaders Anointed by the King, or Black Latin and Asians. But the first meaning was Black Leaders Anointed by the King, because I know that if you get to politics and you don't have that anointing for politics, you're going to jail.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just not going to happen.
Or you're going to be resigning.
For you. I mean, you'd be like Jesse Jackson's son, or Corrine Brown, or something like that.
Or Governor Bentley.
You're going to jail. You're going to jail.
So
we look for people. We look for people who have a really solid Christian background, who are really covered by the blood with their faith, and we're not looking for some people that we support and then they get elected and go to jail.
Yeah, exactly. So you got to have character. You got to be committed to the community. You most certainly can't be walking into this saying, "Hey, George, I need 110% from you, and let me know how it works."
Yeah, let me know how it works. It's like, oh, well, you gotta buy some signs. You gotta lease an office at least.
It can't be your mama's basement. So that's what can't be the mama's basement. All right, good. George T. Farrell, Black Pack. Listen, we've laughed a great deal, but we know how serious this matter is. As we begin our campaign for putting more urban conservatives and more Blacks and more Latinos in the Republican Party and Asians, and not that really all that stuff matters. What really matters is that in cities where there is a largesse of these particular races and genders, we want to make certain that our voices are heard. And so you're committed to promoting faith, family, freedom, and equal opportunity. Tell us, how can people get in contact with you? What should they do? Where should they go? And when should they get in contact with you if they're thinking about running for office?
Okay. Our website, again, if you want to send me a message or if you want to see what we're about, read a little bit about us, is www.blakpac.gop or www.blakpac.com. Go to the website, like it, share it. You can find us on Twitter at Real Black Pack, R-E-A-L Black Pack. And there's a reason for that, Real Black Pack. There's a fake Black Pack out there.
like the Temptations?
You won't believe it. This is true. There's a fake Black Pack. And it was started by the Service Employees International Union, SEIU.
Wow.
About a month before the election, I was so mad that they imitated our first logo and tried to get people to go to their website instead of our website. They spent $3 million to do this, Service Employees International Union, out of Washington. Created a fake Black Pack. And you know, fake, they don't even have any real people on it.
Listen, George, I'm gonna tell you. You and Ray.
But it was imitation of the sincerest form of flattery. So I realized that I really realized what we were doing so effective.
Yeah.
In Florida, we got 170,000 Black Republicans and independents to vote for Trump. He won by 112,000 votes.
Mm-hmm.
North Carolina, Ohio, and Pennsylvania, Louisiana, Texas, wherever we were, we won those elections. We made the difference. And where we don't get in races, we had a congressman here named David Jolly.
Yeah.
Who lost to Charlie Crist by 2% because we sat out that race because he's really a liberal.
Yeah.
You see what's funny, TV shows, and he sounds like a Democrat. I wish he would just switch parties, go independent or something.
Is that, go back home and wish you came. George, it was a pleasure having you on the air with us tonight. We're going to have you back every month, and we're going to work that out where you come on every month with us up until the election. I'm going to be honest. You and Raynard Jackson are two.
And I like Raynard. We talk about once a month.
Exactly. And we accept him because, you know, he's okay. He didn't go
to he likes to fight with everybody.
Exactly. He didn't go to the right high school. That's his problem. But you guys are tearing down some walls, and we need to make certain that you all are promoted on a monthly basis on our network, and we're going to make certain that we do that. George T. Farrell, Black Pack, he's an author, he's a real estate developer, he's just an investment owner, just an overall great guy. And ladies and gentlemen, if you plan on running for office, you need to get in contact with him right away so that we can make that happen for you. Ladies and gentlemen, George T. Farrell. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, when we come back, we'll be talking with none other than the great one himself, Lonnie Poindexter, the icon of conservative Christian talk. You are listening to the Exceptional Conservative Show live from the nation's capital. I am your host, the Exceptional One, Kim McClinton. We will be right back. And I want you all, when I come back, I'm going to make a big announcement to you all. I want y'all to know that this show is pretty well listened to. So we'll be right back.
From the war front to the streets of our nation's capital, men of faith, Dr. Michael Jones, the underground professor, and Kenneth McClinton, the exceptional conservative, bring both constitutional gravitas and spiritual perspective on today's issues to the most influential Christian urban talk show, 9.05 p.m. Eastern, Thursdays. It's a new day on New Day, Black and Red.
Human by race, Christian by faith, American by nationality, conservative by choice. It's Reverend Ralph Chittums, the right guy, on the Exceptional Conservative Network from 4:05 to 6 p.m. Monday through Friday. The right guy on TECN.
The dream deferred is real. You've been waiting for the Exceptional Conservative Network, and now it's here. Go to theexceptionalconservativeshow.com. Tune in and get the best in urban conservative talk. Stop dreaming. It's real.
You are listening to the Exceptional Conservative Network. For more information, go to www.theexceptionalconservativeshow.com.
Welcome to Lion Chasers, where faith and public policy intersect. And now, your lion chaser of the good fight of faith, Lonnie Poindexter, on Urban Family Talk.
We're not saying that there's not instances where there's maybe racial injustice somewhere. This is America, and people are human, and the son of the world, he's a president of first. He's the first president to say that America is not a Christian nation anymore. But, you know, we'll pray for our enemies while we defeat them.
You can't blame folks for messing up the city. There has not been an elected Republican in council in Baltimore City in over 50 years.
In the co-captain's chair with me today, Reverend Ralph Chittums. What's happened is the social justice movement has now been hijacked by a godless movement.
Welcome down, ladies and gentlemen, from the Douglas Boys Aid.
It's not black or white issue. It's a God versus anti-God issue. And I know those would say, well, it's all rigged. It's all a game, Lonnie. Because I get that a lot. And they're the crew that has their bags packed at the train station waiting for Jesus to come back. Wait a minute. I'm not training by another train. I don't know if it's in Jesus. But he's coming. Meanwhile, Rome is burning. The host of the Black Man Deacon radio show. Welcome to the show, Stanley Levy.
Good morning, Ronnie. How are you?
The core issue to build elephants aren't in the home. We've got to do away with the entitlement programs and the things that hamstring us.
And that's where the conservative viewpoints really resonate for my generation.
Welcome to the show, the host of the Exceptional Conservative Show, and that's my brother Kenneth McClinton. Welcome, brother.
Ronnie, it's an honor and privilege always to be with you. Ever-expanding audience.
Let your listeners be Lion Chasers with Monty Poindexter. If Lion Chasers sounds right for your station or network, contact Will Addison by email, waddison@afa.net. Encourage your listeners to be Lion Chasers with Monty Poindexter and Urban Family Talk.
Ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, we were not able to connect with the great one himself, Lonnie Poindexter. We hope that he'll pop into the chat room. If not, I do want to talk with you all about an issue that it's going under the radar in most urban jurisdictions because they don't want to talk about this. First and foremost, let me explain to you all something. Homosexuality is not natural. Because we got 20% of our listening audience comes out of Washington, D.C. And I know that a lot of people get angry because basically I'm told by government officials that 20% of the population in Washington, D.C. is LGBTQRSTUVWXYZ. That's what I'm told. Although I really believe it's more like 2% than 20. It's all of where you put the decimal point in front of the zero or after it, you know, but the bottom line is, they say that this is a very queer city. And whether it's the mayor, city council, police, it doesn't matter. If you are queer, you have special protections under the law. That's just the way it is. And so when we think of homosexuality and those who are trying to make homosexuality the equivalency of heterosexuality, one created by God, the other created by sin, and you kind of figure out which one of those was done by whom. The bottom line is that you have to recruit individuals to become something that they're not geared to. And I know you HB2ers and North Carolinians who are listening and yeah, we did it for the kids. No, you didn't. You didn't do it. Nope. You didn't. You didn't do it for the kids. We don't want them to be growing up to discriminating. No. There's a natural reason why we want women to go to the women's room and men to go to the men's room. Just simple as that. But apparently, because the queer dynasty rules in places like Washington, San Francisco, New York, Chicago, Atlanta, and now Seattle, you're not going to hear stories like Seattle Mayor Ed Murray. Now, I'm going to put this in the chat room, and you all basically figure out for yourself. I'm not going to make you understand something. I just want you to see where we are with a certain mayor. Now, I know Governor Bentley down in Alabama, who's had a divorce a couple years back as a result of his relationship outside of marriage and up on ethics charges as well, earlier this week resigned from his post of governor. That has been deemed to be a wise decision on his part. And quite frankly, I thought it was a wise decision as well, because he's taken a lot of air out of the room, per se. But you have a mayor in Seattle who is saying it's been a difficult week. Why has it been a difficult week? Because a 46-year-old man known as DH, filed a suit against Murray alleging that the mayor in 1986 paid DH for sex. Now, I mean, come on. I mean, what you do in your private room and everything? What you do in your bedroom? I suppose that's just, that's you. You know, it's not important. I don't know why we're even talking about this, kid. He paid for sex. Ah, a lot of men pay for sex. Yeah. And so what if it's a guy he paid for sex? Yeah, I understand. But for those who are listening to us on SHR Media Live, thank you so much. For those who are listening to us on Red Nation Rising at 2 a.m. in the Liberty Channel, I know some of you all will be departing very shortly, and I wish you all the very best. Have a wonderful evening. We'll be back tomorrow night with New Day Black and Red. But I wanted to go over this with you. I want you to understand why there is censorship in the American press and why the majors are not picking up this story. Now, the DH is the guy, 46-year-old man now, but the accusations include rape. Now, I know. Listen, North Carolina guys got college guys got they were accused of rape. It ruined their lives, right? And that's understandable. But accordingly, in the suit, DH alleges that Murray has a mole on his scrotum. This is just how definite this thing is. On Tuesday, Murray was examined by a doctor for signs of such a mole, and he released the results of the exam publicly through his attorney. Murray said about the past week, there are no two ways about it. It's been a difficult week. As I stated last week, the awful accusation made against me is painful to me and my husband, Michael. It is also simply not true. I vigorously denied it when I was first made aware of it and will continue to do so. Without offering any evidence, the accuser has described me in very specific and intimate detail, and his accusation depends on these descriptions being accurate. No, not really. If this description is inaccurate, the accusation cannot be credible. Yesterday, I provided material evidence refuting the accusation. The accusation should be laid to rest. Now, for Murray, DH's attorney, Lincoln Borgaard, asked to depose Mayor on May the 2nd. And as well, Councilwoman Kahama Sawant broke from the rest of the city council and released her own statement on the affair, although she didn't address the specifics of the allegation. The Seattle Times published an editorial asking Murray to step down. The editorial board is afraid that a vulnerable Ed Murray could open the doors for an even more progressive candidate to win election this year. That's from the Seattle Patch, ladies and gentlemen. Why is this not coming to the fore in the American press? Well, there's some people who say, well, you know, it's an accusation. Nobody wants to talk about that. But where there is sometimes smoke, there's fire. Bill O'Reilly came under enormous pressure over the past couple of weeks for sexual harassment charges and civil settlement suits. And he's being castigated by the American press, especially on the left, for being a man who, quote-unquote, doesn't have good character. So why is Seattle propping up this mayor? Well, the truth of the matter is because of the absence of conservatives. What? Kid, how you get all the way around that corner and blame me? We have given up urban America. We have surrendered urban America to progressive characters like de Blasio, a communist in New York, and other progressives throughout Washington, D.C., Miami, Chicago, you name them, Marxists, socialists, progressives, whose intent is not to protect the least, the last, and the lost, but actually to offer them up as a living sacrifice to those who are entrenched in power and have access to wealth. A bumpy week, is it, when you're being accused of rape, solicitation, adultery, I suppose, if there is such a thing in homosexual marriage. And so this I have to ask you, Mr. and Mrs. American Conservative. What would it take for you to get involved on winning urban America back? Would it be that you finally come forward and support candidates of character who believe in such things as faith, family, the Second Amendment, the First Amendment, the Constitution itself being the law of the land? Or will you continue to hang your head and tell people like George T. Farrell and Raynard Jackson and Ken McClinton, you guys don't win anyway. Why do we want to involve ourselves? Here it is. Many a man and woman and child visited Africa to evangelize it and to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And successfully, you've done so. At least your ancestors have. Some of the most conservative evangelicals in all of the world and conservative Catholics in all the world happen to be in Africa. In fact, we were just a few votes away from having a conservative African pope. And now when you ask them, they say to us, because you lack character and because you lack morals, we don't need any more evangelists coming from where you are to us. We need to send our evangelists to you. Ladies and gentlemen, surrendering urban America has opened up the actual treasure trove of misfortune and oppression. So much so that the immoral left will tell you that it is better to fight for one immoral individual and keep him in office, despite what may have happened in his past, than to surely take on a more progressive Marxist socialist to rule their city. One of the favorite quotes that I have out of the movie Wall Street is that a man and his money, a stupid man and his money at least, are lucky to get together in the first place. Actually, it's actually fool and it's money, but nevertheless, you get my point. Ladies and gentlemen, don't surrender, urban America. It's time for you all to stand with me and recover what we lost a long time ago. That's just the moral thing to do. We'll be right back with more of the best in urban conservative talk. Coming up, the Kraken himself, ladies and gentlemen. Ralph J. Chittum Sr. You're listening to The Exceptional Conservative Show, live from the nation's capital. I am your host, the exceptional one, Ken McClinton. This is Sackheads Radio Night. Make certain that you stay tuned for Sackheads Radio Night, coming up at 11 p.m. Eastern Time, right after my program.
The bloviating Zeppelin. He's big-footed enough radio shows to last a lifetime, courtesy of Sean, Clint, Ken, and Jersey Joe. Now it's time for him to waddle on his own 2 feet via the glorious SHR media. Gird thy loins for the bloviating Zeppelin's berserk Bobcat Saloon, coming soon to ossicles near you. Excelsior.
Hi, my name is Willie Lawson of The Willie Lawson Show here on the Exceptional Conservative Network, Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. They told me that I needed to be humble, but I couldn't figure out how to do it. So I decided to be awesome instead. That's The Willie Lawson Show, Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. here on the Exceptional Conservative Network.
Shekinah Ranch is involved in helping youth through the snags along the pathway to adulthood. The last 8 years have created greater challenges. Having a president to parade perversion to our youth has generated the need for us to ramp up our character learning 100-fold. Today's youth are confused. Our goal is to give them a fresh understanding of creation, moral clarity, respect for authority. In short, restore absolutes and boundaries. Boys are born boys and girls are born girls. God's design. Right is right even when no one else is doing it. The Exceptional Conservative Network is underway to raise $10,000 to help advance this mission. Together, let's reverse the confusion aimed at our youth. Don't be a spectator. Go to our donation portal and make your financial contribution, and do it now. Your gift goes towards helping youth get clarity, moral clarity. Thank you.
How about the separation of mosque and state? Hello, I'm Ron Edwards. On today's page from the Edwards Notebook, once again, progressive hypocrisy rears its putrid head. Every day in some government school across America, an ideologically depraved educator is on the muscle against Christianity, promoting the balderdash lie that there's a wall of separation of church and state in the U.S. Constitution. Of course, we all know that is not true. So, I find it hypocritical when Muslim professor Arij Zafari at Rollins College in Winter Park, Florida, repeatedly told students that the Bible and historical accounts of Jesus' crucifixion was a hoax. Normally, when a professor says something that students either don't understand or agree with, at the very least, they ask for evidence. But when student Marshall Polston asked for evidence and didn't agree with the Allah follower professor's statement, she claimed the student harassed her. Of course, video evidence proved the professor to be inaccurate and was not harassed. But guess what? The obviously biased college suspended student Marshall Polston anyway. School president Grant Cornwell defended the Muslim professor and now says there were other factors. Yeah, May such spiritual tyranny be soon defeated. I'm Ron Edwards.
Sponsored by the Tri-County Liberty Coalition.
Great deals are springing up at New York & Company. Starting today, 50% off everything, no exclusions. Plus, only $10 for the perfect shirt, 40 styles to choose from. Dress up time, over 200 options, from maxis to fit and flare perfect for everywhere, starting at $16.99. Find on-trend, on-sale dresses from the new Ava Mendez collection. Hop online or to stores to get 50% off everything at New York & Company.
I know you know someone that has a negative vibe, and if you're trying to make it the only
time for an unpleasant blind guy, conservative bite. One of the great things about having your own show is that you can sometimes indulge yourself. But it's no good if it doesn't do the people who listen to you any good, because then you just wind up looking like a great big tool. Now, there are some who would say that that's exactly what I am, but I'm not concentrating on them this time. See, back during the holidays, an acquaintance of mine indicated to me that the skills that I have to do this program are, to his mind, non-existent. This individual, by the way, has never liked the fact that the Unpleasant Blind Guy was picked up first by High Plains Pundit and then by SHR Media. The person I'm talking about is one of those people that has to bring himself up by trying to knock others down. And he chose to attack me based on my skill level, indicating to me that I had no right to take pride in the skills of political and social analysis that I have developed over the past 48 plus years, implying that such pride made me a snob. Now, I did set him straight, but it got me to thinking. I've heard many times from people who listen to my program and others that some of those around them who aren't too happy with the fact that they've taken a stand in the current conflict between good and evil in this world have chosen to attack them based on their skills, telling them that there's nothing special about them, what they do, or the goals they want to achieve. Well, people, here's the truth. Our skills are gifts from God. Some of us have many, some of us have a few, some only one, but everyone has one. We can use these skills to help define who we are and how we interface with the rest of the world. And we can use them to achieve worthy goals. And here's one other part that the detractors always seem to forget. God made each of us different from everyone else as individuals. When you combine our God-given skills with the singularities that are ourselves, you have something very unique. A good example would be a skilled NFL quarterback. His skills set him apart from other quarterbacks. He uses those skills to achieve goals and succeed. Those skills have not only been given him by God, but he has enhanced those skills with plenty of hard work. So his skills have set him apart. There is no reason for that NFL quarterback to be ashamed of his skills and not take pride in them, just as there is no shame in you taking pride in the skills that God has given you. Never let anyone call you a snob because you believe that your skills set you apart from others, because they do. Your skills, combined with the person you are, make you unrepeatable. So don't let some knick-knack, tally-whack, throw-themselves-a-bone buzzkill diminish you by trying to convince you that you should not take pride in the gifts that God has given you and the gifts that you have worked hard over time to refine. As long as you remember that your skills set you apart from others, but not above them, you can use what God has given you and move on to personal success, regardless of your goals.
This has been an Unpleasant Blind Guy Conservative Bite.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's my very good friend, Dave Milner. You will find him in the chat room almost every night here at the Exceptional Conservative Show, along with Mary Brockman and Claudia Cheek. I love you all. You all are so such stalwarts of our conservative program here out of the nation's capital. You're listening to the Exceptional Conservative Show on the Exceptional Conservative Network. We are certainly not ashamed of the good news of conservatism, for it is the power of liberation, first to the Republican, then the Socialist. Great interview with George Farrell earlier tonight. We got to have him come back. And there is so much that we need to work on to recover the inner cities, urban America. But it's going to take a yeoman's effort from those in the conservative movement to remove the barriers and the blinders in order to overcome the hindrances. Also, if the last conversation that we had in the last portion of the hour didn't impact you in any way, I think forthcoming some of the things that we'll be talking about tonight will. We have gotten to a point in America where morals and character are being questioned and being dealt with on both sides of the aisle. But their standard isn't our standard. And so I want to talk with you all about that as we go on. What do we have to do? We have to give him a phone call. Okay, that's what we will do. We will give none other than my very good friend. Of course, you know him as the Kraken. We also know him as Ralph J. Chittums, the right guy. You hear him from 4 to 6 p.m. on the Exceptional Conservative Network. We attempt to get in contact with him tonight. Probably he and Lonnie are hanging out, avoiding phone calls at all costs. There you go. Good evening, Ralph J. Chittum Sr.
Good evening, and how are you, Mr. Exceptional?
Exceptionally well tonight. So glad to hear from you, sir. Tell us what time it is.
It is time, rising from the depths, dripping wet with the knowledge of conservatism, to educate the Republican and vex the progressive. Release
the Kraken. The Kraken is being released tonight, ladies and gentlemen. It is so good to talk with you. Listen, I hear that you're hanging out tonight with the United Airlines CEO, Oscar Munoz.
Yeah, we're trying to get thrown out of a better place tonight.
Listen, I had a wonderful conversation with you earlier today on your program regarding the Munoz fiasco, the United Airlines fiasco. I want to get your opinion on this particular hour, your thoughts regarding how United Airlines handled the matter regarding getting people off the plane.
What they did was just flat out stupid. And the problem is they doubled down on it with the worst PR campaign that I have seen since I don't know when.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this was worse than Kendall Jenner and the Pepsi commercial. But within 6 hours, the CEO released three different press releases. But the first, my employees did the correct thing. Yes, we love to fly and beat their behind at the same time. And then the next one was, I think we made a mistake. And then the last one was, I think we need to be whoever is in the communications house, whoever is trying to write their press releases, that whole staff needs to be fired.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. That was a communications fiasco.
And then they need to hire Sean Spicer.
At least he talks about Hitler. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, God, that was so... You know, what he said was technically correct.
You got to give it to him.
Hitler did not deploy chemical weapons in the theater of war, on the battlefield. He did not. But here's the first thing that anybody involved in communications 101 should understand.
Mm-hmm.
You never, under any circumstances, make a comparison where Hitler comes out being the good guy. You don't do it.
We're talking with the Kraken tonight, ladies and gentlemen, and we're talking about Sean Spicer, who is the press secretary for the President of the United States, had a bit of a fiasco yesterday discussing or at least comparing what happened in Syria with what happened in the 1940s with a guy named Hitler. And you're right. I don't know how you can justify the comment of making Hitler look like a choir boy.
Right. You know, you're going to give Hitler, you know, points. Oh, well, at least he didn't use gas on the battlefield, dude. He killed. What, 14 million?
Wow.
Well, at least he didn't drop, you know, chemical weapons on the battlefield. No, you don't get to add that caveat to the end of, okay, he killed 14 million people. Oh, but at least he didn't gas any soldiers. You have got to be a freaking idiot.
You know, he did it the conventional way. Why can't we say that? Hey.
You know, it's like, come on, man.
You know, like I said before, there are just certain things that you don't say in Broadcasting 101 or communications winner. I don't know whether he went through press secretary corps, but if you're going to bring up Hitler, you got to always associate him with Satan or something worse. You know what I'm saying? It's got to always be something worse.
Right. You never give. How do you give Hitler the moral high ground? I mean, we're saying it and we're laughing, but come on. How do you just, you know, it's like saying, oh, Mussolini wasn't a bad guy. Damn, he kept the trains running on time.
You see, he did. Yeah, he did. There were fewer passengers, but at least he got to... Wow.
You know, and then we should bring him to the States to run Metro. We were doing a bang-up job with those train schedules. Like, no. There's some comparisons you don't make.
Yeah, that's
the end of discussion.
Yeah, I think we got to wrap that one there, boy. Sean, there are better days ahead. Just forget about that day. Put it behind you, man.
Yeah, just go to bed, have a drink, take a pill, do whatever, get up tomorrow morning and start over.
Just start all over.
You blew this one big.
Yeah, and Lord knows, whenever Andrea Mitchell, NBC News, has a moral high ground on you, you've had a pretty bad day.
Yeah, literally everyone that I've spoken to a person, when they heard the comment, everybody's reaction was, oh, crap.
Yeah, I know. It's one of those things where it's kind of like when you're shooting a free throw and it's an air ball and you know it is and you just wish you could grab it back.
Nope.
It's gone.
I mean, everybody who heard that statement, they literally just grabbed their head, dropped their head, and just was like, oh, my God. I can't believe he just said that. And there was no way to pull it back.
None whatsoever. Listen, I want to talk with you about a big story that's coming out in Washington, D.C. And this is important because, quite frankly, the rest of America doesn't understand exactly what happens to us. When you're having bad days, we're smiling and enjoying and very gleeful here in D.C. When you're having good days, all hell is breaking loose here. Apparently, there is, with this hiring freeze now, which has been in place for the past several months, which included the Obama administration as well, thanks to Congress, there are a number of federal jobs that have been lost. About 16,000 federal jobs have been lost or expected to be lost through 2021. Your thoughts, sir, on the impact that this is going to have. This is going to be a continual one as we begin to look at the 20% across the board budget cuts by the Trump administration.
Well, everyone has been saying that the federal government has been bloated for years.
Yep.
This isn't a new statement.
Mm-hmm.
What's happened is you finally have a president who's doing something about it.
Yeah.
Now, the temporary hiring freeze that President Trump put in place is being lifted. So there are going to be positions now that are going to be filled going forward. But think about it. Every president in recent history at some point in time has bemoaned mm-hmm. the ever-growing, ever-burgeoning federal payroll.
Yeah.
Every president. But now we finally have a businessman in the White House who's looking at it, and he's saying, why do we have all of these redundancies in different silos?
Mm-hmm.
Why is HUD running the identical program as Health and Human Services, as the Interior Department? They're all doing the same thing. They're operating independently in different silos. They're not talking to each other. We're wasting money. So here you have a guy coming in at a businessman who's looking at this and he's saying, this makes no sense.
Yeah.
Is this program worthwhile? Yes. Okay. Then let's consolidate it into one agency, get rid of the other two. If we need to bring in some people from those other agencies into this agency to consolidate the effort, fine. And if we don't, get rid of people.
Yep.
Isn't that how a business is run?
Well, exactly. And I don't understand why the District of Columbia, well, I understand why the District of Columbia is concerned, because if there is a $30,000 positions that will be cut at the federal level, you're probably looking at about 10,000 to 15,000 that will be cut at the district level. And we're already a bloated D.C. government at this particular point. But the tough times are going to begin rolling down the hill. And what Stephen Fuller, and everyone knows him in D.C., the economist from George Mason University, who does the studies on the impact of government affairs on the district and on the federal government and so on. He's predicting that over 30,000 jobs are going to be cut, but at the federal level, which is looking at probably about 15,000 at the state level, D.C., that's just opening ball here. The Trump administration is talking about a 20% cut across the board in every agency.
But all the people need to remember that when you're talking about a 20% reduction of staffing across the board, you're not, these agencies just don't exist in Washington, D.C.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, you're talking about the Interior Department, you're talking about national parks, you're talking about rangers, you're talking about tour guides, you're talking about, so, you know, people just need to just take a step back. Yes, the agencies may be headquartered here in the nation's capital, but these agencies have tentacles that reach out across 50 states and all of our territories.
Yes.
So it's not like, you know, the DMV area is going to be unilateral in taking this hit. Now, these are going to be cuts that need to be made across the agency, across the nation.
But you know Eleanor Holmes Norton is not going to tell it like you just told it. Eleanor Holmes Norton is going to tell everybody in Washington, D.C. that they're about to lose their houses, their cars. They might have to ride Metro instead of getting that Jeep to pick them up in the morning. You know?
Well, the truth of the matter is, for years, this D.C. has been recession-proof because the government, instead of being about accomplishing anything, has been more about a middle-class maintenance program.
Yes, very much so.
And that's not the function of government.
Mm-hmm.
The function of government is not to maintain a middle class. You know, we can get into a philosophical discussion of the primary directive of government and the function of government, you know, vis-a-vis the United States Constitution. That would take us a week and a half.
Exactly.
But clearly, you know, the role of government is not to ensure that Americans have jobs.
Thank you. And that's something that we've been fighting since Franklin Delano Roosevelt in the early 1930s, going through the 1940s at least. The whole idea that it is government's job to not only protect, but to guarantee employment of individuals. That's just not the way it's supposed to work. And unfortunately, there are children who are graduating from public universities and private universities who have taken on that mindset. And this is going to be a complete shock to them when they're filling out their federal employment form for employment, and it's not going to go through. It just won't.
Well, no, it won't. And, you know, and we also have to understand from a cultural perspective, you know, inside the Black community, the reason why you really have this mindset is for a large section of the Black community, the federal government or your state or local government became your employer of first choice, because in some places, and let's be honest, in some places, mm-hmm. if you were Black, you weren't going to get hired. So the mm-hmm. government became the employer of first, second, third, and last chance.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. so for some families, they bred that into their children.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know, you heard all the time growing up, you know, what you want to do is you want to get a good government job, work 30 years and retire.
Yeah.
That was considered successful.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so now, fortunately, I'd say with this new president, with President Trump, the shift is going back to no. It is not the government's job to guarantee you a job. It's not the government's function to guarantee you health insurance. It's not the government's job to guarantee you a whole bunch of other stuff. You have a responsibility to step up to the plate and do certain things for yourself.
You know, we were talking on your program earlier. We're talking with the right guy, Ralph J. Chittum Sr. We better know him as the Kraken. We were talking about the entrepreneurial spirit that is missing in urban America and why young people who are not going to get good government, DC guaranteed summer employment should look at entrepreneurialism as an opportunity. Is that the process that we should be talking with our kids about even before applying for a summer job?
Absolutely. America is still the land of opportunity. How can someone immigrate to this country, come here with limited to no English language abilities, and inside of 30 years become firmly entrenched as a middle class individual, whereas you have third, fourth, fifth, 10th generations in some families, and they are barely eking out subsistence living off of welfare. Because the first generation immigrants coming into America see the opportunity and they go out and get it.
Yes.
And don't sit back and wait for the government to give it.
Exactly. Exactly. And unfortunately, there are individuals here, and we've been told that if you pile in billions of dollars into education, that our children will have a better shot at getting that good government job. But even that's not the case anymore.
And the prime example I always use, the guy that I knew at one time who had the highest net worth was a guy with a high school diploma who went through an apprenticeship program as a plumber, started his own business as a plumber, wound up growing that business to the point that he had a fleet of trucks with his face on the side of it, wound up selling the business for seven figures, and the company that bought out his company still brings him in as a consultant because that's how well he trained his employees, and he did that with a high school diploma.
Bingo. So you don't need a Harvard degree and a good government job to make it in America. Is that what we're learning tonight?
Well, here's the fact of the matter. When I go to my bathroom in my house, and I pull the handle on my toilet and something malfunctions, I don't need somebody with a law degree from Harvard. I need a damn plumber.
Thank you. But I want to talk with you about this, and we're talking with the Kraken tonight. Kraken, there are those who say that if you have a couple of degrees, and you are certainly the more esteemed of all men, that you are worth more and a better person than the janitor. And we've heard that in our communities for a long time, and it kept a lot of us out of the opportunities that go along with doing, I guess, what we would call menial labor. Your thoughts on that?
I go back to my prime, to the example I just used.
Mm-hmm.
Your toilet breaks. You tell me how valuable a law degree is.
Yep.
Your electricity in your house goes out. You tell me how valuable a medical degree is.
Mm-hmm.
What happened in America is the teachers' unions got together with the liberal elites at the universities and convinced America that a college degree was the absolute key to success in America. And that is a lie. So you have a whole bunch of kids now running around degrees in black studies, lesbian studies, English literature, you know, American history, and they can't do jack with them, but they're running around now with $300,000, $400,000, $500,000, $600,000 worth of student debt, and they will never make enough money in their lifetime to pay back those student loans.
There you go. Very, very well put. It's the curse of liberal propaganda. It's what we fight every single day.
Absolutely.
Every single day. And I would prefer a man with grit under his nails than one who's had his pedicure on any given day, because there's a certain experience that goes along with that. And quite frankly, it's missing in our society. I want to talk with you real quick about sanctuary cities, because this is coming up next week. There is talk, well, blame going around now. They're going to blame the House Freedom Caucus again, because they're looking for more money for borders, which includes penalizing sanctuary cities. Washington, D.C. is a sanctuary city. Your thoughts, sir, should we expect the federal government to take away nearly $1 billion from D.C.?
Yes. How's that for a short answer?
There you go. Great answer.
if you thumb your nose at the federal government, refuse to enforce federal law, how can you then turn around and expect the federal government to continue to underwrite you? You know, there's a phrase that I grew up hearing all the time, and that phrase was, you want to be grown? Be grown.
Be grown. There you go.
That means you're going to be grown, handle your own business. And that's what President Trump and the federal government need to tell Washington, D.C., California, and all of these other alleged sanctuary cities. Oh, you are not going to abide by federal law? Well, how about this? We're no longer going to fund your foolishness.
Now you know the Democrats are saying that if we ask for penalties against, I don't know how it's a penalty when it's really not doing the law, but it's a penalty against cities that provide sanctuary cover. And if we ask for any border money, then they're going to walk away and shut down the government. Why is it okay for Democrats to shut down the government, but it's not okay for conservatives?
Because it's a double standard, and it's okay for them.
Yep.
but then again, when you consider, you know, states like California and the District of Columbia, you know, if they shut down the government, honestly, would there really be any appreciable harm?
No.
It might be a good thing if those governments shut down.
It's always a great thing. The less federal government you got, the better off you really are. Please. I know that y'all worry about cashing your checks, but they have worked out an arrangement so you can get paid unemployment while you're waiting for your government check to be paid to you. It's a real crapola of a scenario and situation for all of us. I want to ask you in finality here, because this is a very important thing. We have... And in this particular case, the President of the United States, who pulls the lever while dining with Xi Jinping from China. Putin just met with Secretary Tillerson. Your thoughts on what's happening around the world in terms of Syria? And are we stepping too far in a point where we can't retrieve ourselves?
I don't think we've gone past the point of no return, but I think from a psychological perspective, think about what just happened.
Mm-hmm.
President Trump is sitting at dinner with representatives from China. Mm-hmm. While he's at dinner, he just fired off 59 cruise missiles into Syria without blinking an eye.
Mm-hmm.
See, this sends a message, whether people like it or not, that the United States is not to be trifled with.
Yeah.
I will bomb your city and eat my steak at the same time. And not get indigestion.
And share cake with you.
Right. Oh, yes. Oh, the ambassador from China loves his chocolate cake. It's the best chocolate cake. We at Mar-a-Lago, our chocolate cake is exquisite. Oh, yeah, by the way, we just bombed the crap out of Syria. You know, I mean, come on.
Which, and today...
Now, if we want to get into the philosophical discussion about whether or not he should have bombed Syria, whether was there enough evidence that Assad was actually behind the bombing, maybe it wasn't Assad, maybe they bombed a weapons depot that the Syrian army, that the Liberation Army of Syria was stopped. Okay, we can have all of that discussion. Fine.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's at least say this much. For the first time in 8 years, we have a president who is not afraid to act. And that alone is going to change diplomacy on the world stage.
I agree with you.
Why do you think China now all of a sudden is saying, Mr. President, I really think we can work together and do something about North Korea? Because in the back of China's mind, they're going, holy crap, he might actually bomb North Korea, and we'll all be screwed.
You know, it brings a whole new meaning to Marie Antoinette's "Let Them Eat Cake."
Right. It adds a level of psychology to international relations that we haven't had since Reagan.
Wow. Wow. That you can actually, you know, I got to give my props to my brother, Donald Trump. I'm calling him my brother tonight. That's my brother. Because literally, sitting at the dining room table with one that you consider not your peer, but your enemy, and looking him dead in the eye when you got 59 tomahawks headed towards Syria, and you eat cake? Oh, my God.
And then the story breaks, and this guy from China is sitting at the table going, this fool just bombed Syria and didn't blink an eye and served me cake. It's like, what the hell?
I'm sorry.
It's a paradigm shift in international relations.
You know, I think everybody in urban America just needs to go, you know, props to that brother. You know what I'm saying? My boy. That's my boy right there. That's how you handle your stuff. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, like I said, we can argue about the appropriateness of it, should he have done it or not, but we have to admit that his action of bombing Syria has completely changed international diplomacy. The United States is now viewed as a nation that will kick your butt.
Yeah. Yeah, you know what? And I'm also glad that people are referring to him as Mr. President and not Obama. You know what I'm saying? Everyone was like, we love Obama, but we're scared to death of Donald Trump. I like that.
Well, come on. what was Machiavelli's Prince? What was the premise of Machiavelli's Prince? It is better to be feared than to be respected.
Loved. That's right.
Come on. So that's straight Machiavelli. You know, I may love you, but I'll still kill you and overthrow you.
Yeah, you know, hey.
But if I fear you, I'm just going to leave you the heck alone.
Now,
to those who are listening, no, I am not proclaiming to be an adherent of Machiavellian philosophy.
There you go, you but evil in, man, you.
But in this one instance, we do have to admit that there is some definite truth to that statement, that for the prince, mm-hmm. for the leader of the state,
mm-hmm.
it is better to be feared than to be respected, because fear brings a certain level of hesitancy for one's enemies that respect does not.
Mm. Now, I know, and I know what Dave is saying in the chat room. Dave says, I'd rather be respected than feared. You can love someone and understand they'll put the hammer down if necessary. But we had love. We had Obama. There was much love around the world for Obama. And the apology tour and every. Listen, and I'm not saying that we should stay in Syria.
And you know what respect gets you? This is what respect gets you.
Mm-hmm.
The use of chemical weapons will cross the line in the sand. Assad, the hell with you. I'm dropping chemical weapons.
Yeah.
What does Obama do? Erases a line, backs up 10 pages, and draws another one.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's what respect gets you. Mm-hmm. Now, Donald Trump says, drop chemical weapons again and find out what happens. I bet you ain't nobody going to drop any more chemical weapons.
Not anytime soon. Yeah, I mean, you got ships headed to North Korea. China has 150,000. Thanks, Dave, for putting that up earlier. And we talked about it last night with our guests. Denise Gary Pandol, 150,000 troops on the border of North Korea from China. Literally, North Korea is getting the message that you know you on your own. We ain't in this.
And the last thing, China does not want war to come back to that peninsula.
Nope, they don't.
Because they can say what they want, because China is making way too much money from that other little part of China that they don't want to talk about, where capitalism runs rapid.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get a war breaking out on the Korean Peninsula, all that money mm-hmm. from that little part of China that nobody wants to talk about is mm-hmm. going to dry up. Mm-hmm. And China's economy is going in the tank.
Exactly. That was well understood at that chocolate cake. I think I'm going to have chocolate cake this weekend. Share it with
me. Yeah, me too.
Let's go have chocolate cake and celebrate.
Yeah, double fudge cake.
Double fudge. How can people listen to you, man? You're awesome.
Well, listen to me. As you know, I'm on the same network with The Exceptional One Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. The Right Guy with Ralph J. Chittum Sr. from 4 to 6 p.m. I won't be broadcasting this Friday because I'll be wearing my other hat. I'm also an ordained minister, and so I'll be doing a couple of services this Good Friday. So I won't be broadcasting, but, you know, check me out on Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays from 4 to 6. And please visit my website. Go to www.blackelephantconsultants.com. I have blog posts up and other information. Reach out to me. I'd love to hear from you, the listeners of Mr. Exceptional.
You know what? We need to get you and Raynard Jackson and George Farrell in the same room. We got some big elections coming up, and I think there's another conservative uprising coming. We need to talk.
Absolutely.
God bless you, bro. Have a wonderful weekend.
All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was the crack himself. We got to put him back. When we come back, we will be talking with, hopefully, Shannon Wright. She will be dropping the mic. You're listening to The Exceptional Conservative Show live from the nation's capital. We are not ashamed of the good news of conservatism, for it is the power of liberation. We'll be right back with more of the best right after these messages. Let me put these messages up. Here we go. Okay, come on, guys. Let's get the messages together.
Our amazing hosts at the Exceptional Conservative Network broadcast 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. However, sometimes they get lonely. Be the solution for HLS, host loneliness syndrome. Join us for advice, delightful conversation, and debate in the world's best forum, the Euro Pacific Bank TECN chat room. Go to theexceptionalconservativeshow.com right now. Join us in chat by clicking on the TECS tab, Bible study tab, or TECN tabs. The host you'll save makes TECN amazing. We'll be back after these messages. I'm Ken McClinton, chairman of the Exceptional Conservative Network. Never has the cry for economic liberty been more resounding in urban America than on Election Day 2016. It's the economy! All real change begins with the American entrepreneur. Socialism did not work. Progressivism stole the wealth of individuals and families. You voted for something different. Real change. But what does real change look and sound like? It looks like Las Vegas, and it sounds like Freedom Fest 10. Freedom Fest, the world's largest gathering of free minds, is a popular liberty-minded conference at the beautiful Paris Resort in Las Vegas from July 19th to the 22nd. Hear the voices of the Urban Freedom Movement, Deneen Borelli, Larry Elder, Gina Lofton, Helen Rowley, Juan Pablo Andrade, and Zayad Abdel-Nour. Share ideas with powerful liberty movement figures like Steve Forbes, Jim Rogers, Anthony Scaramucci, Jennifer Grossman, Naomi Brockwell, Dinesh D'Souza, John Stossel, Lisa Kennedy, Peter Schiff, and our keynote speaker this year, William Shatner. Your money, your liberty, your freedom, your city. Come for the real and return with the change. Register now at freedomfest.com for $100 off the regular registration rate when you use the all caps code TECN. We'll see you there.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have some legal obligation, some type of jurisprudence agreement that I have to uphold lest I be sued in open court, the court of public opinion, by White Mamba and Dave Milner. So I must warn you when this commercial comes on, to get your cigarettes together. Let's go out towards the front porch, gentlemen. It's one of those particular parties. It is the, of course, the Melanie Collette Money Talk with Melanie commercial. Take it away, Melanie. No? Okay. You'll take that.
You are listening to the Exceptional Conservative Network. For more information, go to www.theexceptionalconservativeshow.com.
Get your cigarettes.
Money Talk with Melanie is a lively discussion of global, domestic, and kitchen table financial topics. Join your business diva, Melanie Collette, as I speak with respected entrepreneurs, CEOs, authors, and politicians as we explore today's fiscal environment. Money Talk with Melanie airs every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10:05 a.m. Eastern Standard Time on the Exceptional Conservative Network. Remember, this is important because it's your money.
The best late-night conservative talk show in America, Black Heads Radio. And listen, there are no people better on the air to give you the best in conservative talk than Sackhead Sean and Sackhead Clint. And we're working on the immigration papers for a certain other guy who happens to work here, too. For those who are tuning in around the world to the best in late night conservative talk, Sackhead's Radio.
Good morning.
I'm Michael Wright.
And I'm Shannon Wright.
Okay, folks, that's not how it goes. I think I'm Shannon, and you're
so.
Michael.
Yeah.
Okay. We are The Right Way with Shannon and Mike.
Join us from 7 to 9 a.m. Eastern Time.
Live on SHR Media.
And on TECN.
Where we'll be talking about all kinds of things.
From sports and politics.
To food and entertainment.
To money.
Family.
And anything else in between.
Community, holidays, all kinds of things.
It'll be great. Join us from 7 to 9 a.m. Eastern Time.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
I'm Michael Wright.
There you go. Michael Wright and Shannon Wright. They on vacay. I got no answer. So I can't connect with them, and I'm not going to try anymore. They're on vacation this week. That's why you haven't heard any live shows. They posted some pre-records. You can always check it out at SHR Media. But ladies and gentlemen, I assure you, quite frankly, they are probably having the time of their life, and they deserve it. They really do. Now, I want to show everyone something. Can we get the camera here? Hopefully we can see this. I want to show everyone, first and foremost, I know that there's some networks that don't do this, but I try to induce success. I know that I'm considered a tyrant, a lordsman, a gentleman who basically drives the individual into the complete sand. Ladies, Clint is already in the chat room. All right, Clint. Oh, my God. You know Clint didn't get into the chat room at shrmedia.com by himself. Yeah, they had to type him in. So I just wanted to say that. They're coming up, SHR Media, Sackhead's Radio Show at 11 p.m. Shannon Wright and Michael Wright have been just phenomenal on their daytime morning show. And I asked them to do something that they were not prepared to do, but they accepted the challenge anyway, and that's to wake up so early in the morning to go live at 7 a.m. And early on, there were statements towards me. Clinton must have taken his vitamins tonight. He must have. Let me digress. I asked them to wake up at 7 in the morning. Now, they were not necessarily the most gleeful with that proposed morning show idea. However, they took on that particular challenge. And I told them that I wanted my morning drive and my afternoon drive shows to be the cornerstones, that they should have the greatest amount of listeners, that I would be doing the greatest amount of promotion of it, and I would encourage everyone to listen to them. And I really do want you all to download the mobile app for SHR Spreaker, so that you can listen to the shows in the morning at 7 a.m. and at 4 p.m. in the afternoon. Best drive time shows in America, hands down. And early on, Shannon and Mike were a little bit distressed by the fact that they were doing solid substantive programming with a few kinks. You know, they got to work it out. They just started doing this. Is their first time ever doing radio in which they actually produced it, directed, engineered it, and actually hosted their own program. So, and that's Shannon and Mike. The Right Way with Shannon and Mike on SHR Media and TECN, 7 a.m. Monday through Friday. And so they were a bit aghast at the whole idea of getting up so early and not seeing and I just want y'all to know, if you ever get into radio, it is difficult to build an audience. It's also difficult to lose one once you built it. But it's very difficult to gain an audience. You got to build that thing from the ground up. And they were a bit tender with me because, you know, hey, you know, this is work. And it is actually a lot of work. Promoting yourself on Facebook and on Twitter and on Google Plus. And unlike many of my fellow hosts, I'm not well loved on many of those social media platforms. So I'm just saying. So Shannon came to me one day and they were finally getting off the ground. They were getting a lot of listeners, but not at a level that would satisfy them completely. So I said, Shannon, if you get to a certain mark of listeners, and listeners graded on SHR, this is not just TECN, but specifically on SHR, because I love Sean, I love Clint, BZ, and Sacco, and I want them to get a lot of cred. So we drive a lot of the listenership to SHR Media. I said, if you hit a certain mark, I will make certain that you have coffee. Now, you all, if you listen to Shannon and Mike in the morning, you know Shannon doesn't wake up for the show till about 8:30. That just, it ain't happening. Not unless she has a gallon of coffee, including the beans. Including the beans. Thank you, Mary. Ken's a pro at 7 years experience. I told her if you got to a certain mark, I would make certain that you had coffee. They got to that mark, and I made certain that they had coffee. Then we had a conversation. And we talked about the fact that, you know, she was always the rough girl. As pretty as she is, a beautiful woman, but she was always the tomboyish one. And they were always trying to put frills on her. And while she was reaching out to play with the boys' Tonka trucks and things of that nature, they took those things away from her and gave her crayons and other things. So treated like a little girly girl. She says she always wanted to have a Hess truck. And so I said to her, if you get to 5,000 downloads and live plays before Freedom Fest, I will get you a Hess truck. Now, y'all don't know Shannon. She's like a little baby sister to me. Y'all don't know her like I do. But, and she will jump all over me for telling you all this, but that little woman began to tear up. It was the one thing she always wanted in her childhood that she never got. And quite frankly, never thought she would ever get in her adulthood. You know, because people always give you dresses and, you know, things like that. But she always wanted a Hess truck set. Well, if she hits over 5,000 by the end of this month, well, which is well before Freedom Fest, she will be receiving her Hess truck. There it is, ladies and gentlemen, for you to see. That's her Hess truck. We got it for her. And it also comes with two sports cars. You'll see there, right there, the comes with two sports cars. Okay. So that's what we will be giving her. For those of you following along at home, there you go. You can see it on the live stream. And you can also see it on Ustream. This is how much I love my people. I really do. I love them with all of my heart. I know the hard work that they put in to do these shows, to produce them, to edit them, to direct them, to do, they do everything Fox does, and they do it at zero. They don't get paid for this, although that we're working on getting advertisers for their programs and for all of our shows, working out a marketing plan right now. They get up every morning, and they put on their Sunday best for you. And we appreciate you all greatly for tuning in and listening to them from around the world, whether you're in Great Britain or in Singapore or in Baltimore. And to be earnest with you, 8% of our listening audience comes from Baltimore, those who go to the domain. And I know why they're doing it. They're listening to Shannon and Mike every single morning. And so I want to thank her and Mike for doing such a wonderful job. And that type of activity on our network and on SHR is so well appreciated, because they are, along with what George Farrell and Raynard Jackson are doing, knocking down the walls that have been built up, eliminating the persecution that we've received as urban conservatives. Our message is getting out there and is being listened to around the world. They are the number two show on TECN. Also, Willie Lawson's number three. They're in a big, tight race right now. So I really appreciate them for their big race. And you can find Willie Lawson on at 9 a.m. right after Shannon and Mike. So they're in a big, heated race right now to be the number two. But I won't let them get anywhere near close to number one, because by the end of this week, in fact, I think tonight, the Exceptional Conservative Show will be the absolute number one show on SHR Media, the number one show in live plays, and the number one show in downloads. And I want to thank you all so much for all you all have done to support us in our endeavors to spread the good news of conservatism around the world, to talk about capitalism to a culture that was built on government job first, to preach the good news of the Constitution and that it is the law of the land and not civil rights, and to also talk about conservatism in a way that people understand that they are really hearing conservatism from the King James Bible every single Sunday. Yes, the Christianity that actually was the foundation for our nation. So with all that said, I want to thank you all, our listeners, for making us so great. Coming up, 11 p.m. Eastern Time, Sackheads Radio. Sackhead Sean, Sackhead Clint, BZ, the Bloviating Zeppelin, who told me that if it were not for him, there would be no Sackheads Radio, that he is the gift, the bomb, the diggity. We love him so much. That's why we like to get him in trouble. With all that said, if you don't remember anything I said tonight, remember this. God bless America. It's time now for America to bless God. We'll see you tomorrow night, New Day Black and Red. Go to SHR Media now. SHR Media. SHR Media. There you go.